How are you guys doing? It's good. It's so good to be with you guys. My name is Andrew Chalmers, and I'm so excited to be in Murfreesboro, Tennessee tonight. And our team, we have a team of probably six or seven people that are actually here with me, and you guys will get to know them this weekend. And I just want to, first of all, let's give a hand to the team who helped kind of assemble this event and get different people together. Can we just give them a hand? Yeah, we are just so excited to be able to work with some people, you know, here in the community and here in Murfreesboro to see this city transformed and revitalized. And you guys just saw a video that we produced probably over the last year or so, and you guys kind of got to hear the vision and what Take the City is all about. And you know, the last person that you saw in that video, what's amazing is really the greater part of that story that she doesn't tell. But you know, actually, we sent out a team on Thanksgiving Day, and they had food, or a week or two before Thanksgiving, and they were giving out food, and they went into this neighborhood and they knocked on the door and they had food in their hands. And when they showed up, her and her family were in the house, and when they showed up with the food, they said that they had literally hours before been talking about how they didn't have any food for Thanksgiving, and they were going to pawn their television to get some money to go get Thanksgiving food for their family. A couple hours later, a group shows up at their door with food for Thanksgiving. It was a huge answer to prayer. Their whole family came to Christ like immediately. It was like, wow, this is awesome, you know. And they gave their lives to Christ. And then what's even cooler is they actually ended up doing outreach in their own neighborhood, and they started hosting a like a grill out in front of their home in this trailer park where they live. And so it was really, really cool to see how God can begin to transform neighborhoods as we go out and we take the message of, you know, the gospel of Jesus Christ into our communities, and that really God can transform our cities through the gospel. Amen? Awesome. So what we're going to do this weekend, I want to kind of give you guys an overview and ask you to pull out your folders. These are awesome folders that they're called Generation, and the team here, they put these together for you guys, so they look awesome. They have a packet inside and a schedule inside, so you guys can check that out, and these will be a big help to you guys this weekend while we are with you. And what I want to do is I just want to get everybody ready and kind of have an understanding of what we're going to do this weekend and where we're headed. If you guys will turn the first page over, you'll see kind of the table of contents. And every session that we do, every training we do, we're going to have all the notes right there for you, so you can read along as we go through the different sessions. If you flip the page over on the sessions, you'll have an activity that we're going to do after every session. And then we also have a place after each session that says places you can go deeper in this subject. And so I really want to encourage everybody to hold on to this folder, hold on to this packet. If you'd like to, you know, come back later, we're recording these sessions, so go back later and check out some of the sessions, or you can share them with other people and maybe even do Bible study based on these in those scriptures that you look into. But really, if you look at the table of contents at the top, it says what our goal is this weekend. So we don't want to do this event aimlessly. Like, we didn't come up here without an aim and without a purpose. We actually have a goal and objective for everyone that's here, including myself. And we're all on the same journey, right? Learning and discovering more and more about who Jesus is and how we can become more and more like him. Amen? And so we're all on that journey. And so each and every person in this room, honestly, you're going to get different stuff probably than the person sitting next to you. And that's my prayer, is that wherever you're at, that God would just breathe on these scriptures, whether it's the first time you've heard them or studied them, or the 150,000th time, you know, you've heard these scriptures. I pray that God would just breathe on them, and that he would speak fresh revelation to each of our hearts this weekend. The goal is written at the top, and I'm just going to read it to you. Our goal this weekend is to journey with you. Say journey. So we're all on a journey. You know, when this weekend ends, you're not done. You know, it's really, we're just continuing that journey of following the Lord. And we want to journey with you this weekend in discovering the joy of representing God's love and goodness in everyday situations. And so the goal for this weekend is that we would journey together. We're going to spend lots of time together. We're going to be doing teachings, but it's not just going to be you sitting here listening to me talk. We're actually going to put into practice what we're learning after each session. We're going to really allow the Holy Spirit to bring it from our head to our hearts. Hopefully, in Jesus' name, we're gonna talk about the scriptures together. We're gonna pray for one another. We're gonna spend time together, and our prayer is that each and every one of us we would discover in a greater way the joy that we can have in representing Christ everywhere we go. And so, as we do this, I just want you guys to really have your hearts open. I want us all to just be ready to hear from the Lord. And I'm so excited to see you guys here, because what I know is if you're here, you're hungry to see this city transformed. I know that if you're here tonight on a Friday night, you know, you worked all week, you've been busy, you know, whatever's going on in your family, all, you know, you got plenty of other responsibilities, but you chose to came here tonight, probably not to hear me speak or you because you knew about Take the City or, you know, probably none of that, but probably most people in this room, the reason you're here is because you say, you know what, I do want to see my city change. I do want to be a part of something that will transform Murfreesboro and Nashville and the surrounding areas. And so I'm excited that you're here, because I sense that everyone who did come, that you guys are hungry. What we're going to do is as we go through these different sessions, we're going to take time, we're going to begin the sessions, and then after that, we're going to actually split everyone up into groups. And the whole weekend, we're going to have you guys all in the same group. And so it'll be kind of like a huddle group that you'll get to know the people. Hopefully they'll be from different churches. In fact, when we split up into groups, we're going to ask you guys, like, kind of get with some people that you don't really know. We want you guys to be able to build relationships with those groups and do the activities together with them. So the rhythm of this weekend is going to look like worshiping, adoring Jesus, learning and studying a little bit of the scripture, hearing some testimonies, and then getting into groups and in community, talking about what we talked about, praying about what we just talked about, and really activating what we're teaching on. Because what we don't want to do is just give you a bunch of head knowledge and then you don't know what to do with it. What we want to do is really present something, allow God to breathe on it, and then let him activate that truth in your life. Amen? So I really want to ask you guys, get involved. You can participate. You can talk to me. And we're gonna be working with your teams. And so get to know your teams. And most of all, just have a good time this weekend. Hopefully this is not just like a normal conference or something that you sit through. Hopefully this is really something unique that you'll be able to enjoy. Amen? Awesome. Well, let's just pray. And then we're going to get into the first session. Father, we thank you so much that you are here. And God, that you have brought each and every person here for a specific plan and a purpose. God, you have something special for us tonight. God, I thank you for this city. The city of Murfreesboro belongs to you, Jesus. And we thank you, God, that there are many lives that are going to be touched this weekend as we go out and we just share the love of Jesus everywhere we go. Holy Spirit, I pray that you would speak to us tonight through your word, God. Your word is life. Your word is truth. Your word is like a lamp to our feet. You show us how to live and where to go through your word. And so, Holy Spirit, we ask it tonight that as we're studying even some of your word, maybe we've read it 1,000 times, God, I pray that you would breathe on it and that you would make it come to life for us tonight. And God, that we would be bold and that we would be humble and be willing to apply your word to our lives, God, that we would say, you know what, the way I'm living today isn't the way I always want to stay. I want to live more like Jesus than I am today. I want to be more like him tomorrow than I am today. God, I pray that you would just release a hunger over each and every one of us, God, to receive from you. In Jesus' name, amen. Awesome. So the first session tonight, what we're going to be looking at is a session on identity. You guys say identity. Awesome. And so many of you guys have probably heard teachings on identity, and I pray that this will just continue to add to things that you've heard about knowing who you are and knowing who God is. But I also pray that there will be new things that God will speak to you. Mark Batterson, he says, how you think of God will determine who you become. A.W. Tozer, he says, the most portentous, which means the most revealing or foreshadowing thing. In other words, the thing that reveals kind of your destiny and where you're headed about any man is what he at any given time may say or do. So it's not what those things are, but what he in his deep heart conceives God to be like. In other words, A.W. Tozer said that what a man perceives God to be like determines his destiny. Chris Valentin, he says, whatever Jesus is to you, he will be through you. And I love all these quotes. Tozier says, the way that you perceive God determines your destiny, not only eternally, but here in life right now. Your perception of God changes the course and the decisions that you make and the places that you'll end up going. You guys agree with this? Not only does it change that, but also the way that you present who God is through your life. In other words, the way that you demonstrate what Jesus is like is 100% about the way that you perceive him. Your life is like a mirror. The way that you perceive God to be is how you're going to present him to be in your everyday life. I'll give you guys an example. How many of you guys have a friend or know somebody in your life who's really, really good at doing basically making fun of people, but doing imitations of them? Can anybody think of someone in their life like they can do really good imitations, maybe of famous people or people in their community? Have you guys ever seen someone who's really good at it? Raise your hand. Okay, so we in our community, we have a very special dear friend. His name's Gabe. And Gabe is amazing. He is like the life of the party everywhere he goes. And one very, very special thing about Gabe is that Gabe, when he gets everyone's attention, one of his favorite things to do is imitate people that are in the room or imitate people that we all know. You know, so basically what he'll do is he'll start acting like me, for instance, and he'll imitate like the way I pray, or like right now the way I'm preaching, like kind of like my stances and, you know, like the little mannerisms that I do. So Gabe will get up in front of the room. Everybody knows me and kind of what I'm like. And so when Gabe gets up and he does this imitation of me, it just, everyone starts cracking up. It's so hilarious because he's doing it. It's just like me, you know? And have you guys ever seen someone do an imitation and you're like, wow, that is just like that person. And it's so funny to be able to see someone who can do an imitation of people. And one thing that I've realized about people who are really good at imitating others is that people that are good at imitating others are studiers of people. The reason that Gabe can get up in the middle of a room and imitate me so well is because just naturally, when he's sitting like in a room like this, not only is he listening to the sermon and hopefully, you know, receiving great revelation, but he's also like picking apart like little things that I do and noticing them. He pays attention to little details about who I am. He picks up on small things. Essentially, Gabe is good at studying people. Someone who's a good comedian or someone that's a good imitator of things or can do good accents, essentially they're just really good at studying like people, the way they talk, their mannerisms. And that's what Gabe is so good at. And the people that you know, essentially they just know how to really study what people are like and then start practicing and trying to imitate them. Well, this weekend, the premise and our goal is what? It's to discover the joy of representing Christ in our everyday situations. So this weekend, we're going to go on a journey. We're going to have tonight and tomorrow, and we're going to discover how much joy we can have in our lives when we represent who Christ is everywhere we go, in our work, in everyday situations. But before we can really represent who Christ is, we have to make sure that we're actually representing who Christ really is. Because what we don't want to do is have an understanding of God that's actually incorrect and contrary to what the Bible says. And then we'll go out and what will we do? We will misrepresent God. And how many of you guys know there's people in this city, especially in the Bible Belt, there are loads of people who have been hurt. Why have they been hurt? Because someone has misrepresented who God is and what he's really like. Well, why have people misrepresented Jesus or God? Why? Because they hate God and they hate the church and they want people to stop going to church? No, most of the people that they've been hurt by are actually like leaders, deacons, Sunday school teachers. So do you think preachers and Sunday school teachers are like out to like destroy their church and make everyone hate God and not want to go to church? No. What's the issue? The issue is the representation of who Jesus is not really who he is. They're misrepresenting him. And so if people are really experiencing Jesus in your life, they're going to want more of it. But if they're experiencing a misrepresentation, they may or may not want any more of that. More than likely, they're not going to be very interested. And so tonight, as we talk about identity, what we're talking about is this. We need, as the body of Christ, to have a biblical and a Holy Spirit inspired understanding of who God is. And as we understand how good and how incredible our God is, then we can truly represent him. We're going to represent who he is. For us to be an imitator of Christ, what do we have to do? Just like Gabe, we have to sit there and watch the speaker, the little mannerisms, you know, how I use my hands, like, you know, I always go like this or whatever. You guys are going to notice all that stuff the whole weekend now, you know, going like that. Yeah. So, you know, but just like Gabe, he sits there and he notices all the little things. We too need to become students of who Christ is in the Word, in the presence of God, by the Holy Spirit. Allow him to illuminate. Wow, God, that's who you really are. And as he starts to breathe, you know, into that revelation, as he starts to give us that revelation, guess what happens? We will actually begin to more accurately represent him in our everyday situations. So in order for us to be a representative of Christ in our everyday situations, truly, we've got to get a correct understanding of who God is. Amen? Not only do we need to understand who he is, but we also have to understand who we are. Because we may have a semi or a correct understanding of who God says he is, but then also believe that we're not who he says that we are. And that can actually cause a lot of damage as well whenever we're going out and doing, you know, doing different things. One thing I just want to share really quick is when we go out and let's say, okay, we're talking about representing Christ. We're talking about evangelism. We're talking about changing our city. And let's say you guys get really well educated in how to transform your city, but you go out and all of you guys are commissioned. Go do it. Go change the city. Do a bunch of stuff. And I send all of you guys out, but you go out and maybe you have a slight understanding of who Christ really is, but you don't have an understanding of who says he says that you are, then you can go out and you can actually begin to go out and everything you're trying to do is trying to prove that you're something you don't believe you are. In other words, you think, okay, maybe God said I was a son, but I don't feel like his son really. And so by transforming my city or by doing this outreach or by praying for this sick person, I'm actually still just trying to prove that I'm something. But when we understand who he says that we are, we're motivated completely out of love whenever we're going out and sharing the love of Christ, and we're able to actually represent him well. How many of you guys have ever had a Jehovah's Witness come to your door? How many of them cuss at you or yell at you or are mean to you? None, okay? They're not typically mean. They're actually typically pretty nice. They're very polite people. What's off besides doctrine and, you know, misunderstandings of the scripture? What's kind of off when they come to your door? Pressure. Pressure. It's immediately they come and what do you feel? Pressure. Why? Why are they putting pressure on you? Why do you feel that pressure suddenly? That pressure comes from a belief system about themselves, which comes from the doctrine that they're taught. The belief system says, you're not secure in your relationship with God. You've got to do more. And until you do more of whatever you're not doing enough of, he's not going to accept you more. And in fact, you may not even make it. You might not cut it. So you better do more. And so when they come to your door, what are they doing? They're putting that pressure on you because of an incorrect belief system about themselves and ultimately about who God is. They don't see God as a loving father who completely accepts them, who sent his only son, and his son died so that you could be forgiven and eternally owned, and so that if you ever go do outreach, it's from a place of knowing who you are and not having to put pressure on people to perform or get something from them, but you just get to love on people with no pressure because you know who you are. You guys see what I'm saying? So two big things. We've got to know who he is, and we've got to know who we are if we're going to represent him well. Amen? Now, as I'm sharing this, you know, I brought up Jehovah's Witnesses because that's a pretty easy example for us. But I just want to be honest. I think in everyday churches and in the body of Christ, especially in churches that are very missionally driven, really active, doing a lot of busy things, I think that same mindset can still be just as prevalent. It's just masked and looks a little different. And the mindset is essentially, I'm not doing enough. You know, and I'm not doing enough because I don't feel accepted. I don't feel loved. I don't really feel accepted or loved by God. He doesn't totally love me. Like, I mean, I know he loves me, but like, I'm not doing enough. And so I got to do more, you know? And so what can happen is that same mindset that I was just sharing, the pressure that you feel from Jehovah's Witnesses, like everyday common churches, that can be the same mindset in gospel proclaiming churches, because people are still holding on to lies from the enemy. And they haven't let go of those lies, come out of agreement with those lies and stepped into truth and what the Bible says and started living their lives that way. The reason we're not talking about evangelism tonight or how to share the gospel or even practical ways to transform your city is because, let's say our team comes here. Let's say I show you a bunch of videos. I give you a bunch of 1-2-3s on how to change your city, because we've seen a lot happening in our community. We're from Georgia. We've seen God doing amazing things. But if we were to come here and just tell you a bunch of practical ideas on how you can transform your city, but there's a lot of misrepresentations in our understanding of who God is and who we are, then the whole motive behind the whole movement will be wrong. And so tonight, what we're dealing with is just our heart. And what we're going to do is we're going to actually open up our minds, every one of us, every single one of us, young and old, okay? We're going to open up our minds. We're going to open up our hearts, and we're going to allow Holy Spirit to speak to us and show us, maybe, you know, I know there's probably only one or two in here, but maybe there's some people in here where there are things and ways that you perceive God that do not line up with what the Word of God says. And maybe it's because of experience that you had with your dad. Maybe the way that your dad raised you caused a filter to be put on your perception of who the Father is. And maybe tonight God wants to lift that off and give you a true lens and a true filter of who he is, so that you can start to see him correctly, so that when you go to Walmart or when you go to your school or when you're, you know, going to the coffee shop, whether you're doing outreach or not, whether you feel like praying for someone or not, you're already naturally representing who he is because you have that correct understanding of who he is and what he's like. Amen. I just want to have 4 volunteers come up real quick, and then we're going to break up into groups. So can I have 4 volunteers? I want you to come up here, and you are going to stand right here. 1, 2, 3, go. All right, 4. Come on up here. Ready? Just come right here. All right, give him a hand. Give him a hand. Right here. Okay, so I want 1. Okay, actually, here's what I want to do. I need 1 more. I need 1 more. Come on, give him a hand. Give him a hand. I want you guys to make a circle. I want you guys to make a circle. And I want you guys to go like this and kind of like lock arms together. Okay, and so now what I want to do is I want to get you guys to look at your page. All right, look at your page. There's a fancy diagram there. I did not make up this diagram. This diagram came from a book called Restoring the Foundations. And you guys are going to have to do this for 20 minutes. So like, I hope your shoulder muscles are strong. No, I'm just kidding. Put your arms down for now. Okay. So this model I actually got from a book called Restoring the Foundations. You can read more about it. But basically, it's a diagram that talks about our belief system and how it affects the rest of our lives. Okay. And so I'm going to use these 4 lovely volunteers as just kind of an example up front where you can see what's going on. And so what I want to do is I just want to show you guys this. We must have correct beliefs about who we are and who God is before we can begin to expect him to do great things in us and through us. Once we begin to expect him to act out of his goodness and faithfulness, then we begin to behave differently. That's when we begin to experience life in a whole new way. All right. We're going to talk a little bit about that. Right here, we have the belief. Raise your hand. You're the belief. Right here, we have the expectation. Raise your hand. You guys can put your hands down after. Next, we have the behavior. And next, we have experience, okay? So you guys see, this is the circle that's on your page. And so what I'm going to do is I'm just going to walk around and kind of give you guys an example of how this works. Typically, life starts not actually with the belief, but with experience. So experience, raise your hand. So typically most of what happens as a child, it actually really starts here in this area As you're growing up, it starts with the experience area. What does that mean? Your experiences, you begin to experience things as you're growing up. So things start happening to you, and basically that begins to shape what? Belief. So as you're growing up, you start having experiences. Why? Because you're living and you're breathing and you know you're doing stuff and growing up and your parents are raising you. And as that's happening, suddenly something starts being shaped, and that's what's called your belief system, okay? And then as your belief system is shaped, what that does is it creates inherently inside of you, you can't stop it, you can't control it or make it go away, but it automatically creates what's called expectations. So as you're going through life, you're having these experiences as you're growing up or even as you're older, and as you're having these experiences, it begins to shape your belief system. And as it shapes your belief system, it actually begins to deposit these things inside of you called expectations, which then begin to shape your behavior. And so actually what you begin to expect begins to shape how you will behave. Can I give you guys a quick example? Okay, so, and I'll just give you a quick example that's sort of relevant to this weekend. So let's say, let's start with experience right here. Okay, so experience, typically, I don't know that this happens a lot in experience, but let's just say it does. So somebody is raised in a church, and they are a teenager, and let's say they go to camp, and this power, you know, God's moving powerfully at this camp, and as God's moving powerfully, the youth pastor asks, you know, the kid to come forward, and he comes forward, and he wants him to pray for pray for Johnny who sprained his ankle. Okay, so come on over here, pray for Johnny. I'm gonna have you pray for Johnny right now, and I just believe God's gonna heal him right now. And so go ahead, pray for Johnny. Okay, and so what happens is he prays for Johnny, and nothing happens. And he's 13 years old, he's at camp, the youth pastor put him on the spot, and Johnny didn't get healed. So what happens is suddenly a belief takes root in his life, and the belief is that God doesn't heal through me, or God doesn't heal when I pray, or God doesn't hear me pray. Let's just pull it down to this: God doesn't hear me pray. When I pray, God doesn't hear. So what that does, he prayed, nothing happened. I believe God's real and powerful, but maybe he just doesn't hear me. Okay, so that belief system is created. What happens next? An expectation is deposited in that person. So suddenly he's got an expectation. What's the expectation? Next time I pray for someone, God's probably not listening and nothing is probably going to happen, right? So how does that affect his behavior? This is getting pretty obvious, right? How does that affect his behavior? 5 years later, Johnny sprains his ankle again. Is he praying for Johnny?
No.
No, that his behavior is, I'm not praying. You know, youth pastor, you pray. Yeah, I'll come stand with you guys in agreement, but I'm not going to be the one praying. Why? Because the belief. God doesn't really hear me. God doesn't really know, you know, like, or God doesn't really want to heal when I'm praying for someone. You guys see how this shapes our whole life and changes everything? Let's give these guys a hand. You guys can go sit down. The scripture that I want to look at for this session, and you guys can just open up your Bible if you'd like to, and we're gonna read it. And usually each session will kind of have a practical application, and then there'll be a scripture that we'll look at that, you know, basically like points us to Jesus and what he wants to show us in this session. So we're gonna look at Luke chapter 15, and then we're gonna break out into our groups. How many of you guys are familiar with the story of the prodigal son? Raise your hand if you're familiar with Luke chapter 15. The story of the prodigal son, raise your hand. Go woot woot if you're familiar with it. That was good, TJ. All right. My Bible actually calls it, how many of you guys have titles in your Bible? It says parable of the lost son. Here's what I want to say. In the context, which everything that you read in the scripture, you should actually look at the context of like what Jesus was doing, where he was at, who he was talking to, what did he just say. A lot of people don't do that. They just kind of open up their Bible and they read a verse and they're like, oh, I understand. But, you know, I've been taught that the good thing is to kind of read around and understand like what's going on in that situation. Well, in this situation, I would actually, because of, if you understand the context, I would actually title it a little bit differently. And the reason that I would is if you go back to the very beginning of the chapter, it explains all those things that I just said we should be finding out. It says, then all the tax collectors and the sinners drew near to him to hear him. Okay? So all the kind of people that everyone looked down on, they came around Jesus. And the Pharisees and scribes, so the leaders of the Jewish religion, they all come around. And they said, this man receives sinners and eats with them. Jesus has two people around him in this context. He has a group of sinners and he has a group of religious leaders. So that really helps us understand what's going on. My interpretation is actually these three parables that he talks to are pointed very directly, not at the sinners, even though the sinners are there and they're going to get some good stuff by hearing these parables. If you read all three, and especially if you get to the last one, which is what we're going to read, we're going to get to the end. He's not pointing at the lost son and sharing this nice, comforting parable for the sinners. He's actually pointing this directly at the religious people. Okay? And so I would say really it's the parable of the last son, the second one that we're going to hear about. And so many people are super familiar about the prodigal son, but in my interpretation of this chapter, you guys read it all and you'll understand what I'm saying more. But in my understanding, it's pointing directly at the Pharisees. And here's what happens. And we're going to read it starting in verse 25. Now his older son was in the field, and as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. Okay, you guys remember what happened. The younger son, he leaves and takes his inheritance. He squanders it on prostitutes and partying. He comes back home and Father God, which is representing Father God, Father God just gives him a big hug. He gives him a robe and ring and sandals, and he kills the fatted calf, and his older brother hears about it. And so this is where Jesus really kind of gets to the point of this whole parable. And he says, now his older son was in the field. He was working. Okay. That's not in the Bible. I just said that. And as he came and drew near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said to them, your brother has come, and because he has received him safe and sound, your father has killed the fatted calf. But he was angry and he would not go in. Therefore, his father came out and he pleaded with him. So he answered and said to his father, lo, these many years I have been serving you. I have never transgressed your commandment at any time, and yet you never gave me a young goat that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as, I love that my Bible says make merry with my friends. That's what I would say too. Verse 30. But as soon as this son of yours came, who has devoured your livelihood with harlots, you killed the fatted calf for him. And he said to him, son, you are always with me, and all that I have is yours. It was right that we should make merry and be glad, for your brother was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. I want to point out just two things. Verse 29, he says, lo, these many years I have been serving you. And the next verse, the father says, son. This is pointed directly at the Pharisees. They're in the house of God. They're the busiest people in the whole nation of Israel doing the religious things for Yahweh. They're the most busy religious people in all of the nation, probably in all of the world, for God himself. And yet in the midst of their busyness, Jesus points something out, that in the midst of all their busyness and all their religious activity, something was missing. Their understanding of what Father was like, what God was really like, and their understanding of who they were. And so it affected the way that they behaved and the way that they represented God to all the people living in the nation. The way that they lived their lives, the way that they took advantage of the nation, the things that they were doing, as we read in the scriptures, we find out kind of what the religious leaders were like. The reason they were like that wasn't because they just hated their people and wanted to, you know, maintain power. And I don't think inherently people just want to hurt others or misrepresent the God they serve. I don't think very many people think that, like, oh, I want to misrepresent the God I'm serving. I want to misrepresent God to the church that I'm leading. I think what happens is typically people have a misunderstanding of who God is and who he says that they are. The older son, which is what this whole parable is about, the older son said, I've been serving you all these years. Another translation said, I've been slaving for you. And I like that translation better. I've been slaving for you. What did he believe about himself? Can somebody say? He's a slave. What does that say about his perception of father? He was a taskmaster. He was a slave owner. He was a boss. He was scary. He was distant and out to get them. And that shaped everything they did as leaders. So we as the body of Christ tonight, right now, Holy Spirit is here. I sense his presence is here. He loves us so much. And I just believe right now, Holy Spirit wants to show us places in our hearts where we've come into agreement with lies about the Father. And who's the father of lies? Satan himself. And what was the first thing that the father of lies did when humanity was created? He went to them and he tried to twist the faithfulness and the goodness of God. He wanted them to not really see God for who God said he was. He wanted them to believe differently. And many of us, even born-again Christians, we live our whole lives from a foundation where we still hold on to lies that Satan has given us, the world has given us, or maybe just simple experiences in a fallen world have given us that have shaped our belief system where we still perceive God to be someone that he's not really. How many of you guys want to be able to represent Christ? How many of you guys want to be able to see your city change? It starts right here with knowing who he is and what he's like and with letting him tell us who we are and the way that he sees us. And when we get this right, everything changes. And this whole weekend, what you guys are going to find that everything we're doing is building one thing after another. We're going to take this step. We're going to take the next step. And it's just, it's going to build off each other. But this, we've got to get this right. Amen? Got to start here. We gotta get this thing corrected in our lives. And I want to be honest with you guys. Even in full-time ministry, even like up until now, but I'll just be honest with you guys, a couple years ago, you know, I began to realize that an experience that happened to me, and this may seem so petty, but when I was like 5 or 6, one of my first memories growing up, one of the first things I could tell you that happened to me is I was at a convenience store and I took the candy that I saw in the aisle and I put it in my pocket, you know, and I walked out. And my mom found out that I had taken the candy that I wanted, you know, and taken it out of the store and I had stolen. So what did my mom do? She was like, "You cannot do that. Come on, we're going inside." And she took me inside and she made me, in front of all the registers, she made me give the candy back and tell them that I had just stolen. And my mom did the right thing and as far as correcting me, like what I did was wrong. But the way that I perceived it, that experience for me, what I realized, literally this was just 2 years ago, but I what I realized is that experience shaped my whole life. And this is how it shaped it. I started believing from the age I was 5 or 6, because of one experience, I started to believe that I was just inherently bad. And some of you guys would say, okay, that's stupid, dude. You just stole the candy. Your mom, you should have gotten in trouble. You know, get over it. Okay, I am over it. You know, thank you, God. But what I realized is that experience created a belief system inside of me that I was inherently bad. And what I realized is, like, you guys heard a little bit of my testimony. I ended up, you know, getting addicted to drugs and doing, you know, going through a lot of really hard stuff. What I realized is I was actually living out of my belief system when I was getting addicted to drugs, when I was partying and sleeping around and doing all these crazy things that I was doing. I was living out of who I believed that I was. My parents kept telling me, "You need to go to church. You need to be good. You need to do this. You need to do that." And they kept telling me what I needed to do. And all they were doing is pointing at, on the chart, they were pointing at my behavior, saying, "Change this, change this, change this, change this." But in reality, through experience, over and over and over again, it had validated, right? Those experiences, they validate and will confirm your belief system. So over and over and over again, through behaving bad, what happened? It would validate. Someone would tell me, "You did bad," or "You messed up." And I started believing more and more and more that inherently I was just bad. And so I actually carried that even into ministry. Isn't that crazy? You know, you wouldn't think that. But I carried that into ministry, even just this core belief, like, God's good, you know, I'm bad. And I didn't necessarily live out of that. But one thing I realized is that I was still kind of holding on to that. And I believe that the Lord actually wanted me to release that and to begin to believe the truth. And one thing that God spoke to me when I had that revelation that I was still holding on to that One thing that God spoke to me is that I am a good son and he's proud of me. And that's what he said to me. He said to me, and I'll never forget where I was at. I was in my kitchen. It was early in the morning. I was making coffee. And he said, "You're a good son and I'm proud of you." And I just started to say that. And it changed, you know, Romans 12:1. I was transformed by the renewing of my mind. My whole life started to change.